Party Whip. Mr. President, soon we'll have a chance to vote on the American Energy and Conservation Act, a bill, that's been championed by our colleague from Louisiana, actually both of them, Senators Cassidy and Vitter, and they've done a terrific job of getting us to this point where we're voting on this important piece of legislation. This bill is about as straightforward as it can get. It incentivizes American energy production through revenue sharing agreements with the federal government. This is important because states like mine, especially along the Gulf Coast, spend an awful lot of money investing in infrastructure to support an industry that benefits not just our states, not just the region, but the entire country. And it's time to balance these costs with reasonable revenue sharing agreements such as we have struck in the past. And given these states produce a big portion of the oil and gas our entire nation needs to keep the lights on, it's only right that these states should benefit from some modest revenue sharing. This legislation would make sure that that is possible. So I hope our colleagues will support it when we vote on it shortly. This legislation is a good example of the kind of energy policy that a new Congress can put forward next year and actually have the prospect of being signed into law under a new administration, under a new president. One of the things I think I've observed about the Obama administration is while the president claims to be all of the above in terms of his outlook on energy, he really isn't. He's into picking winners and losers. One of the reasons why many people in coal-producing regions in our country felt betrayed by his policies and by the president was reflected in the outcome of the vote. I think in West Virginia, for example, Mrs. Clinton got 27% of the vote in a state that previously had been predominantly a Democratic state. Well, that's because many people felt like their very livelihood had been taken from them as a result of the regulatory overreach and, frankly, what they call, and I think it's appropriately so, the war on coal. But as I said, all of the above is actually the right policy. It's just that I don't think President Obama ever really meant it. A lot of folks try to paint with broad strokes about energy. Either you're on the side of the environment, climate change, or you're on the side of innovation and new technologies, or you're on the side of traditional oil and gas development. Well, I would dare say, and this may come as a surprise to some of my colleagues, that Texas actually produces more clean energy from wind than any other state in the nation. I know we're known as an oil and gas state, and that's true, but we really do embrace an all-of-the-above strategy. And I think it's really helped our economy stay ahead of the national economy, even during tough economic times for the country. So you can have literally an all-of-the-above policy, one that works well for the environment. Matter of fact, because of fracking and horizontal drilling and the ability to produce more natural gas in the United States, we've actually seen emissions into the environment come down dramatically because more people are opting for natural gas rather than other sort of fuel sources. So this is, frankly, a win-win proposition. We know that, as I said, Texas is known as leading the way in oil and gas production, and this fact was underlined and emphasized just this last week when the U.S. Geological Survey announced that one shale formation in the Permian Basin near Midland, Odessa, contained the largest estimate of continuous oil that they've ever surveyed in our country. Now, this should give us a little bit of humility when it comes to making long-term predictions. Back, I don't know whether it was 10, maybe 15 years ago, there was some discussion about something called peak oil. In other words, the argument was that we had basically discovered all of the oil and gas that there was to discover, and there wasn't any more out there. Well, this just shows how time and time again people underestimate the initiative and the ingenuity of our entrepreneurs and the people who work hard, our scientists, to create new technologies to help us move forward. That's why I'm optimistic about our country as long as we don't stand in the way of those innovators and those entrepreneurs. Well, in Texas, we've learned the best policies sometime are just to get the government out of the way, off our back, out of our way, with its hand out of our pocket. Frankly, letting the experts do their jobs with limited bureaucratic influence. That's something the whole country can benefit from, and I'm hopeful during this new administration under President Trump, working with Republican majorities in both houses, we can begin to untangle the stranglehold that the regulatory state has imposed on so much of our economy, whether it's in the banking industry. I see the chairman of the banking committee here. He knows this topic well. The regulations put on our small businesses, on our energy producers, all of this has stunted the sort of normal economic rebound that you'd see following a recession like we had in 2008. So I'm looking forward to getting a lot done to help free up our nation's economy, and in particular by promoting our nation's energy resources. We used to think of natural resources as a tremendous benefit and a comparative advantage one nation has over another. But I have to tell you, we've squandered those natural advantages we've had in this country by not unleashing this sleeping giant of American energy. It's not just important to our economy, it's important to our national security and the world order. Because as we all know, in Europe and elsewhere, people like Vladimir Putin use energy as a weapon. And when people have a sole source of energy, and it's from Russia, and he can turn it off and on at his whim, that creates a lot of problems for them and, frankly, keeps them from asserting themselves in the world order. But by providing export capacity, like we did with lifting the export ban on oil in December, and hopefully doing the same thing with liquefied natural gas, something we have in abundance, cheap liquefied natural gas that we can provide an alternative energy supply to countries in Europe and around the world. So we need to seize this opportunity to reform the regulatory process. We need to address the renewable fuel standard, which is not working for anybody, and build on the energy renaissance occurring in states like South Dakota and Texas, and North Dakota, I should say, and Texas, and states that take a pro-growth, pro-energy outlook. I'm proud of the energy-friendly environment in my state. The Texas example proves that you can take advantage of the natural resources that God has blessed us with to help consumers, to help seniors, help people on fixed incomes, and we can do this without damaging the environment. We can actually do it and improve the environment, as we have seen in the case of natural gas production and use taking the place of other forms of energy production and a reduction in emissions occurring consistently with that. So it's time we take this know-how to the rest of the country. I want to make it clear that making our energy sector stronger is so essential because it benefits everyone. Number one, it creates jobs. It creates benefits for families who are provided for by those jobs. And it takes daily commuters helps daily commuters out on the roads with affordable energy. And it helps small businesses do what they can do to keep the lights on, not to mention an industry created by a health, not to mention the jobs, as I said a moment ago, created by a healthy energy industry. With the election that occurred on November the 8th, with Republicans in the majority in both houses, and now with President Trump coming into the White House, we can make real strides in energy innovation and production. It's really a historic opportunity if you think about it. And I look forward in the future to discussing even more ideas about how we can capitalize on our nation's energy resources for everyone's benefit. Mr. President.